boards. Recognized around the world as the leader.
SBN. ESPN and the Professional Bowlers Association present the championship round finals of the $75,000 AMF HPL Senior PBA Open. And now let's preview tonight's top five finalists. Local pro Lee Taylor, bowling in his first ever PBA Senior Tournament Championship round, will take on Mr. 900 Glenn Allison of Whittier, California. The winner of that opening test will then face left-hander Darrel Curtis of Kent, Washington. Starting from the runner-up position, the only player to shoot 300 this week, 17-time champion Dave Soutar. And, of course, waiting in the wings to bowl just one game for his fifth career PBA Senior Championship, it's the doomsday stroking machine, Earl Anthony. Welcome, everyone, to beautiful Palomar Lanes, located in Escondido, California, for tonight's championship round finals of the $75,000 AMF HPL Senior PBA Open. Hi, everybody. I'm Denny Schreiner, and welcome to Escondido, California. And on the telecast this evening, we have three Hall of Famers, an outstanding cast. While we're on the subject of Hall of Famers, working with me once again for his 10th year here on ESPN is Hall of Famer Mike Durbin. Good show tonight.
It certainly will be, Denny. It's hard to believe it's been 10 years already. As you say, we have three Hall of Famers on our telecast tonight. They're both PBA and ABC Hall of Famers. Glenn Allison in the number four position, and Dave Soutar in the number two. And, of course, as you say, year after year goes by, and that doomsday stroking machine, Earl Anthony, always seems to be on top.
All right, let's talk about the lane conditions this week. The score is moderate to low, but a very fair event from start to finish. We've got a little everything on the telecast.
Well, we did. Last night, Dave Soutar took a 104-pin lead into the final game, and Earl Anthony shot 256, and Dave 175, and Earl came out on top. Well, getting back to lane conditions, what the PBA tries to do is put out a fair and equitable shot for everybody concerned. It's a professional condition, Denny, a lot different than the house condition, a lot tougher. Comparing it to golf, we let the rough grow a little bit, we make the fairways a little bit more narrow, and you got to make better shots.
All right, Michael, you're only as old as you feel. Obviously, Glenn Allison could be concerned less about 60 at this stage. He won when he was 56 back in Canton, Ohio. What are his chances tonight?
Well, I'll tell you what, Buzz Fazio won on the national tour when he was 56, and anybody that can bowl three 300s in a row has got a chance, so he has a chance tonight.
All right, should be an exciting telecast. Stay tuned. The opening match comes up next here from Escondido, California. It, of course, features Mr. 900 Glenn Allison and local pro Lee Taylor. The championship round finals of the $75,000 AMF HBL Senior PBA Open are being brought to you by Bush Beer, head for the mountains of Bush. And by Midas, for mufflers, brakes, and shocks, nobody beats Midas. Nobody.
One athlete has been on the cover of Sports Illustrated more than any other.
Here it goes. I must be the greatest.
A fierce competitor who knew no fear in or out of the ring.
I'll fight that chump in a telephone booth.
Muhammad Ali, boxing's best. And now you can get the incredible story of this sports legend captured on video free with your paid subscription to Sports Illustrated. You'll get an electrifying look at Muhammad Ali only SI can deliver. Free.
I'm the fastest thing on 2 feet, man.
You'll relive it all. His greatest fights, the guts, and the glory. From gold medal winning triumph at the Olympic Games on to the startling rope-a-dope victory in Zaire over a young champion named George Foreman. Recall the grace, the charm, the showmanship, and the mouth.
One more time, who's the champ of the world?
Call this toll-free number now and save over 50% off the cover price. Plus, get the Ali video free. You'll see the heated rivalries, including the three brutal confrontations with Smokin' Joe Frazier, Ali's stunning defeat in Madison Square Garden, up to the thriller in Manila.
And a thriller and a killer when I get the gorilla in Manila.
Definitely one of his most devastating battles ever. Get 23 issues of SI for three easy monthly installments of $9.89 each. That's over 50% off the cover price. You can put it on your credit card. You'll even get the baseball preview and the 1991 swimsuit issue, revealing the latest trends in beachwear, along with the Muhammad Ali video free.
Muhammad Ali is the world heavyweight for the third time.
Call now. You'll save big on Sports Illustrated and get the free video that must be the greatest.
I'm a bad man. I shook up the world.
Palomar Lanes in Escondido, California. First time the PBA Senior Tour has been here, and they've had a lot of fun this week. Fans have been tremendous.
Well, they have. It's a first-time event here, and we haven't been back in the San Diego area for a professional tournament for about 30 years. Escondido is about 25 miles north of San Diego, so the fans have really enjoyed it. Get a look at their local favorite here, Lee Taylor.
Cheered him on last night in the final six games of match play. Taylor comes out, leaves the solid four on his very first shot. You know, this isn't the first time he's been in the championship round. He made it as a top seed back in 1978. However, he bowled the great one, Mr. Mark Roth, and lost in the Light Beer Championship Classic.
Where was that at? Do you remember?
I'm going to say probably somewhere in California. It's probably one of the earlier stops on the winter tour, because I joined the PBA Tour working-wise in the summer of 78 and didn't remember that.
I was bowling in 78, but that's ancient memory, you know, back in the gray matter somewhere.
That's right. 10 years you've been working now as an analyst, Mike. How does that make you feel?
As Lee just holds on to get that four pin, it makes me feel good, Dan. I really enjoy doing this, and hope I can do it for another 10.
And as far as I know, you've still never missed a spare from this position.
Well, I haven't gotten tapped either.
First good look at Glenn Allison, 60 years young and going strong. Really put on a show last night, bowled beautifully down the stretch. Comes out and thought about the 2-4-5 and leaves just the 2-5.
And Glenn, who was near the top all week long, using that little spin shot, kind of going over the top of the ball, getting the ball down the lane and being able to break at the back end with a nice gentle hook.
All he did was come out and average 226 for the first six games and lead this field after the opening round.
Right. He struggled a little bit in a couple of blocks, but as we said at the top of the show, it's been a tough condition, a professional condition all week long. The guys that hung in there made their spares and adjustments and didn't make that spare.
And he was a little surprised. Ball kind of sailed past the two-pin. So Allison opens in the first.
And again, you know, the cardinal rule here, the lead pin there is a two-pin. If you don't hit that lead pin, you can't make the spare. He shot it from the left to eliminate the chop. Classic four-step approach. Ball in perfect time, head steady, shoulder-high backswing, arm out there for balance, the left arm, and look at the follow-through. Still got an open.
Ooh. Waited for that one to hook. It never did, so he leaves the washout, and some adjustment work needs to be done for Glenn Allison on the championship round pair, which this week is 27 and 28.
27 and 28. Interesting, too, this pair was the home of our only 300 game this week, Dave Soutar, but Dave is playing further out. He's playing out between the first and second arrow. Allison has been playing in all week long. Looked like he was going to take a piece of tape out and put it in, but he's going to shoot this spare first.
Tries to go a little more direct, and that looked more like a strike shot than a spare conversion. So Glenn Allison goes open, open. Let's see if Lee Taylor can take advantage of those miscues.
Well, I'll tell you what, if anything was going to loosen you up when your opponent goes open, open, that should loosen that swing.
Taylor with an 11-pin lead. In the early stages, pretty good shot, and the 6-pin kicks out the 10, so Taylor strikes in the second frame.
Lee Taylor holds the ball right at waist high, upright. Four-step, push and pull, push and step at the same time, a little higher than shoulder-high backswing. Nice follow-through, even balance at the foul line. That's how it should be done, then. A little bend at that elbow. See him hold the ball and swing it like this. He's been working with John Jowdy, and John is trying to loosen up his swing, and that's why he does that at the beginning of the swing.
And a beautiful double for Lee Taylor. And how many times have you seen that happen out here on the national tour when one player makes a mistake? Normally, the other one will step up and take advantage.
They always did it against me.
Allison trying to get something started, and it's back-to-back washouts. Now all Glenn can do is turn around with a wry smile and try and start again.
an easy task to come out in the championship round and leave back-to-back washouts.
Especially if you missed a spare in the first frame. That hole he's digging is getting deeper and deeper.
And especially after the guy you're bowling against just goes whack, whack.
Right now, Glenn just wishes he could disappear.
Well, this is a product of the great era of team bowling, Glenn Allison, one of the wonderful players of the 40s and 50s, and for him still to be around in the 90s competing, that's kind of amazing.
Well, he's got that nice, easy style. He's in pretty good shape, takes good care of himself, and he says he feels good. As long as he feels good, he can keep striking like that.
Well, let's see if he gets back up. Yes, he does. Claps the hands together, and Mr. 900 says, well, I've got room for a bunch more in a row. All I've got to do is get a string start.
He said, with that 900, I never shot any spares. There it is. Six taking out the 10. Glenn's reaction. Thank you, he says.
Big strike in the fourth. He waited until they all went down, though. Didn't want to jump the gun. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, Taylor hits the pocket again. 10-pin thought for a moment about standing, but the 8 was almost some company.
Almost had company there with it. On the lane, Denny, right at the second arrow, there's a lot of oil. That's right where Lee's playing. He's going basically pretty straight, right direct at the pocket. We saw Allison's ball when he moved out there shooting the washout. Didn't hook at all. So, you know, if you don't really roll it well there, you can leave that pocket split.
A couple of extra swings to get that arm loosened up. Double bouncer, no problem with the 8. And we had a chance to chat with Lee Taylor before the telecast tonight, and we asked him about bowling in front of the hometown fans. Would that be an advantage or a disadvantage here in the championship round?
Well, normally I think it'd be a disadvantage because I tried too hard. But last night I had lots of fans. They cheered me on. I had my best block, so maybe I'll turn it into an advantage tonight.
Big lead right now for Lee Taylor, who would like to put Glenn Allison away very early on here in match number one.
Well, he knows that if he keeps the ball right in play and keeps it in the pocket, that Allison has to get a lot of strikes in a row to catch him. But as we said, you know, he just missed that fairway that we were talking about earlier. You got to make good shots to get the ball to the 1-3 and then hope you carry. The 4-7-10 here, basically I would think what Lee will do on this is just go for the 2 and maintain good count.
All right, what about your mental attitude when you come into an event where you've gone through the practice session your first couple of rounds and the scores are medium to low and there's inconsistencies from pairs to pair, and you know, some players probably at that point give up because they like high scoring tournaments, but other players like those types of events.
Personally, Dan, at the tail end of my career, I always liked the tougher scoring houses because then spares came into play. As you said, the lanes were different pair to pair. I always figured that favored the experienced player that knew how to make those kind of adjustments. I liked them because I knew that I could keep up then and I had a chance to win on that kind of condition.
And two of the greatest adjustment players of all time, Earl Anthony and Dave Soutar, finished 1-2 in this one.
And two of the greatest shot makers of all time.
Meanwhile, Allison starts to fight back. There's a lot of fight left in this 60-year-old Glenn Allison.
He doesn't give up, and he loves to run out strikes. When he starts getting something going, I imagine what he was like when he shot that 900 series. Right now, that 42-pin lead now is reduced down to 18 pins.
One more here cuts it to 8. He could get right back into the thick of this match. Got to hook a little bit. Yeah, you and I were both thinking the same thing at the same time. So he misses the head pin on the left-hand lane. Not an easy spare.
Well, he's had practice. He's missed it 3 out of 5 frames already, so he should know where to throw this to make it.
And that's what he's saying to himself. I've missed the head pin on this left-hand lane three times.
A little boom, boom.
A little more roll and a spare for Glenn Allison. So we're at the midway point of match number one. We'll take a break here from Escondido, California. A 22-pin lead for local pro Lee Taylor.
She was 2 months premature, 2 months early. It isn't exactly the best way to start your life, spending the first days of your existence all tied up to tubes and monitors. Mom and dad and doctors and nurses obsessed with no other thought than your survival. The first miracle was the technology that allowed her to live. The second miracle was that there was a way to afford it. Capital Blue Cross, Pennsylvania Blue Shield.
My place or your place?
My place, of course. My place has delicious food and cozy dining. Fresh homemade pizza with a variety of toppings oozing with mozzarella. Hot and cold subs, spaghetti, rigatoni, stromboli. And my place has specials like mouth-watering manicotti and fresh veal parmesan. Plus, you can eat and relax in the dining room, or my place has takeout available with a convenient drive-through window.
Let's go.
Where?
When it comes to delivered pizza, you know who gets there sooner. If you want it hot and you want it fresh, you want it sooner. Now for just $9.99, get two medium two-topping pizzas. Call Domino's Pizza.
Championship basketball continues at the National Invitation Tournament. Watch the best field in years in second round action live Monday night at 7:30 Eastern on ESPN.
Nothing quite like Southern California, right, Mike Durbin? Of course, you grew up just a couple hours from here.
Yeah, I grew up in Burbank, California, and I've always loved Southern California. Didn't get interested in golf until I met you, but...
That's right, and you're still learning.
Right. You know,
look at the bright side. There are plenty of years left.
Well, when I got an expert like you to teach me.
That's right, but you're going to be on the senior tour bowling here pretty soon, so then you're going to be, well, in a quandary. Is it golf or bowling at that point?
Well, it was bowling earlier today.
Right. Ahead by 22, but not out of reach at this point. Sweet shot there, though, for Lee Taylor, who mixed up the rack.
See, what I like about Lee on synthetic lanes is how smooth the ball goes into the lane. There's not the, sometimes you hear this boom, boom. With Lee, most of his good shots, it's just smooth, and you can hardly hear the ball hit the lane. I think that's the best type of delivery on synthetic lanes.
You've already mentioned the fact that Lee has been working out recently with PBA Hall of Famer John Jowdy. And I know one of the things that Jowdy really likes to impress on his students is to get the ball down and through the lane constantly, which is what Taylor is doing right now.
See how smooth that was?
With a break, leaves just the 10 pin.
See, the problem then is that if the player goes away with the ball at all, if Lee goes away and he was straight as he throws it, it's just not going to make it back at all. So he's got to point it toward the 1-3 to begin with, and the tendency is you just don't trust it, and you point it a little bit too much, and it goes right through the nose like that shot. It takes an absolutely perfect shot. At the spare. The reason Lee was swinging that ball ahead of time is Jowdy has got him doing that to try and loosen the swing up, to let gravity pull that swing down rather than controlling it with muscle.
His son Mike, outstanding player on the PBA National Tour.
It hooks it more than one ball than Lee will all night tonight.
Mm-hmm. He can get it from one end to the other. Big time rotation. Allison right back at him, and if you make a good, clean, crisp, professional shot, you can hit the pocket. You just better not miss by much.
That's correct, Dan. That's right.
See, so many times, you know, as I travel throughout the country, people say, boy, it was the scores last night on the show, they weren't really that high. And I say, yeah, but it was an excellent show. It doesn't make any difference how high or low they are as long as the matches are close and the lanes are fair.
That's correct, Eddie. And again, you got to remember that we're not trying to put out a condition where the guys are going to average 250 on it. We're trying to put out something that's professional.
This has been the trouble lane, and he got all of that one. Needed some help. Six pin, wiggled the 10. That would have been a key double for Glenn Allison.
That would have got the match within 12 pins. Right now, he's got a hope for a mistake Lee Taylor. Although Glenn still has a potential score of 193 if you pick this up and strike all the way out.
Allison had a high game of 260 this week. His low effort was 158.
Needs to convert this. No trouble.
Normally, Glenn works for us statistically in the truck. Told me this evening that as much as he enjoys working with the ESPN crew, he does get a better payday when he makes the championship round.
Just by a couple dollars.
Right, that's what he said. So, wonderful ambassador to the game for many, many years, Glenn Allison. Down quickly. Boy, a beautiful shot that time on lane 28 for Lee Taylor. If he can put one more together right now, he'll be in excellent position.
His wife looks a little uptight there. He's having trouble breathing.
She looks very nervous.
It's always harder on them.
225 would be his best possible score.
No matter what he does here, Dan, if Allison strikes out, Lee is going to have to show up and bark in the 10th frame.
And that's exactly what Glenn is already thinking to himself.
Top spare, 258. See, the thumb just didn't come out as clean on that shot, and the ball never turned over.
Well, is that the adjustment from the shot he threw before through the nose?
Yeah, the left lane, I don't think, holds as well as the right lane does for him. So he knows if he goes up a little bit too much, it's going through the nose. That time, though, it was the release. He did not get the thumb out of the ball clean.
Well, nine out for Lee Taylor in the ninth. Now his best possible score would be 193. It's a 10-pin match, and this one has changed dramatically here in the latter stages.
And we have a potential of a tie score here. It just never, twice now we've seen professional bowlers miss that lead pin, both times the two pin. The reason they do that is they're afraid of chopping that two off the five. Way out there. He might get six. Might manage seven. Just looking at his thumb, that something happened there. Better than the washouts, though, that he was leaving. But it really put him in a bad situation. He's concentrating here. Watch the ball just fall off his hand here. He's always opened his hand up like that, and he knew it as soon as he let it go.
And shocked at the miss, both players with open frames in the ninth frame, and this is a little bit of giveaway going on here in match number one.
I mean, there was the opportunity. Taylor opened. Allison, if he strikes out, really puts himself in a commanding position, making Taylor get all three. Right now, he's going to equal his low game of the tournament with just a strike spare in the 150s.
And instead of a shot to go ahead, he now trails by 24. Never fails. You always carry when it doesn't mean much.
Then you're relaxed, and then the ball goes to target. Well, if he gets one more, he still makes Lee show up. And as we saw a couple of weeks ago, it is possible for these guys to throw it in the channel.
Oh, anything's possible. There's no such thing as a gimme. What happens? A very solid week for Glenn Allison. Might as well cross over and strike. So one more, and you're right. Lee Taylor has to show up and get something done in the 10th frame.
On the Brooklyn. Way on the Brooklyn.
Yep, Glennie just trying to finish this one out and head back to the barn. This was not the kind of start or finish that he was hoping for here in the championship round.
Well, he needs four pins on two balls. I think either you or I can handle that then.
The Gary Player look here this evening for Lee Taylor. Yep. I think he can handle it, and he does. Leaves a solid four, so Taylor advances into game number two for Glenn Allison, a fifth-place finish and a check worth $2,800. And don't forget, coming up next, Average Builders, the first of the brand-new season with Mike Durbin concerning how you throw strikes on those synthetic lanes.
Hey, what's with the two bottles? You gonna wash your hair twice?
Oh, funny. It's shampoo and conditioner. Maybe you've heard of them.
Yeah, I use them, but I get them both in one bottle with Pur Plus.
That's great, but I gotta use dandruff shampoo.
Yeah, me too. And that's why I got Per Plus for dandruff.
Let me see that. Dandruff shampoo plus conditioner in one. Hey, my hair's clean, easy to manage, no flakes.
Oh, beautiful. So let's go.
Dandruff Control, Pert Plus. Great hair, no flakes, no fuss.
The total number of cheese puffs that you've eaten during championship wrestling and church picnics would add up to one profound puff. But you still wouldn't have a taste as big as these little Gino's pizza rolls. A tremendous taste of zesty pizza and a hot little bite-sized snack. A taste so big, it makes cheese puffs seem a little flat. Gino's Pizza Rolls, the pizza way to snack.
Now it's time for this week's Average Builder, brought to you by Pizza Hut. Here's Mike Durbin with this week's tip.
The next 3 weeks, our seniors are going to be bowling on what I consider to be the wave of the future in bowling. That is, three different synthetic surfaces made by three different manufacturers. That's what I'd like to look at tonight's tip. What are synthetic lanes? What type of shot works well on them? And how are they going to affect you and I, the average league bowler, in the future? Here in Escondido at Palomar Lanes, we're using AMF's HPL 9000 series. And AMF has been kind enough to give me a cutout of a lane to show you how they installed this here in this center. What we have here is an existing wood lane that's been resurfaced. And on top of that, they put panels. In this center, there were 6.5 panels. The dark area is a material called phenolic. And then it has a top coating of a very hard material called melamine. Now, melamine is very, very hard. And the selling point from a manufacturer to a proprietor is that that proprietor will never have to resurface his lanes again. He may have to replace a panel now and then, but he won't have to resurface. And to give you an idea of just how hard this melamine is, I've got a cutout of a lane right here and a ball peen hammer, and I'm going to try and put a dent in this surface. No dent. So you can see that it is a very, very hard surface. Well, what type of shot works best on this very, very hard surface? It's my opinion that the shot that works best is one where we don't hit the ball on the upswing and get the ball well out on the lane. You kind of get the ball down into the lane and get it rolling quickly. Del Ballard is an example of this on the National Tour. Earl Anthony here on the Senior Tour. And earlier this week, our number two qualifier, who bowled the only 300 game in this event, I asked Dave Soutar what type of shot he thought worked best on synthetic lanes, and this is what he had to say.
The characteristic of a synthetic lane is one that hooks a great deal on the back end. It's a high friction lane. You need to pick a ball that will go down the lane a long way and counteract some of the high friction on the back end. So you don't need a ball that hooks a tremendous amount. You'll have much more success on synthetic lanes with that type of ball.
Remember, synthetic lanes represent change in the sport of bowling. But change is not always bad. You and I can learn to bowl well on them if we'll just get that ball down early and get it rolling quicker. We'll see you again next week when we'll have another Average Builder.
Average Builders is brought to you by Pizza Hut. Pizza Hut, making it great. And coming up next, match number two, Lee Taylor will take on left-hander Darrel Curtis. We'll be back with that momentarily.
During the Final Four, Pizza Hut brings four of your favorite toppings together on one great pizza. Introducing the new MVP pizza. Made with pepperoni, mushroom, Italian sausage, and green peppers. Get this winning combination for $7.99 and a second for just $4.04 in delivery and carryout only. So fast break to Pizza Hut because the new MVP pizza won't be around for long.
Pizza Hut, make it great.
There's no dashboard light to warn you. No dipstick to check. Yet when warm, they could cause your car to lose control and break it. Don't find out your shocks and struts are worn by accident. Get your shocks and struts inspected at your Monroe retailer soon. Monroe, your safety could depend on it.
And off the glove of Claudel Washington, who goes into the seats. And here goes Buckner, bad wheels and all, for an inside-the-park home run.
Hey!
Once again this season, if it happens in baseball, you'll see it on ESPN.
Welcome back to Escondido, California. Lee Taylor, Darrel Curtis, set for match number two. 181 to 166, Taylor defeating Glenn Allison in a low-scoring opening game.
Yeah, kind of a boring game. It really wasn't too exciting.
To be quite honest with you, other than Glenn's double, and he kind of made a little bit of a run, but you're right. Let's see what happens here in game number two, of course. Now we've got the left-handed factor involved.
Not looking any better, is it? The 4-7-10 right out of the gate. Oh. Come on, Darrel. Show us a shot here and make it. This purple ball. My goodness. That is bright purple, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't go with his shirt, Danny. I don't know if he should be throwing that.
That might be fuchsia. Is that fuchsia? Tries to make a little run at it, but an open frame quickly for Darrel Curtis. And Lee Taylor has been the recipient of a number of open frames early on.
How many did Glenn have? Glenn had about four, didn't he?
At least. Lee Taylor with a thump-o-matic. Had that one rolling over the thump hole, huh?
He didn't want to let go of that one, Dan. Oh, boy. Could be a long night here in Escondido, I'll tell you.
Didn't want to let go of that one. You're not kidding. For a guy who's trying to lay it down,
yeah.
Of course, you think that could be the long break in between games?
Well, I don't know. Usually that used to happen to me every time I had a single strikeout, but...
Kind of grabbing and hanging on just a little bit.
Well, that span always got shorter, you know.
That's right. Oh, my. Both players opening in the first frame.
I'll tell you, he's fighting his release. He just is not comfortable with the feel of that ball right now. Lane need to be about 6 inches shorter.
Both players trying to get something started. And other than a double in the 10th and a double in the 4th and the 5th, it was an evening to forget for Glenn Allison. 181 to 166 the final there. Well, a double bouncer that rolls a little bit high and ends up with just a 4-pin. Let me ask you this, Michael. When you hang on to one and then drop the other, is it fighting the feel of the ball or is it a timing problem?
With me, it was usually the fighting the feel of the ball. And I'd get into that position where if I put a piece of tape in the ball, I wanted to hang. And if I took it out, I lost the ball. So what I wound up doing to counteract that is a lot of times tearing the piece of tape in half or taking it out and blowing in the thumb hole, which created a little moisture and helped me to hold on to it.
Hung on to that one a little bit as well, but a spare up for Lee Taylor, who breathes a sigh of relief. Darrel Curtis is an aggressive type player. Let's see what he's able to do here in the second and the third.
Oh, much better shot. Now you see the contrast, how clean that ball came off of his hand. Darrel is an older player, didn't bowl in the national tour as a regular five-step player. Pretty free swing, head is very steady. There's his pivot foot, low backswing, which usually indicates that you're accurate. Gets the ball about, my goodness, about 3 feet over the foul line there.
After going through the nose, better shot here, kind of dices up the rack, so Curtis comes back with a double.
Darrel throws a lot of strikes, and he's not afraid. He gets into pressure situations and has a tendency to pull the ball and have it go high or Brooklyn.
Set it down short again, leaves the 2-4-5.
And he's just fighting his release. A little double dribble there, boom, boom. We saw in the first match, his real good shots, you hardly heard the ball hit the lane at all, and he got out of it clean. He's just fighting that release. He won a regional senior event over the weekend up in Hemet, California. So he's bowling well and just needs to get it. I think it is with him, his timing a little bit. He has a tendency to get that backswing a little bit higher.
See, a much better shot there. I think some of it might be timing for him right now. Of course, it's been, 13 years since he's been into the championship round.
But you would think after he won the first game, he'd relax and things would start flowing a little bit better. It always worked that way for me. A lot of times I'd be real uptight during the first game. If I got by that, then I relaxed and got more confident.
Plus, you've had a whole game to bowl on the pair, get a little feel for what's happening out there. Down by 13. Keep in mind, Curtis working on a strike. Dave Soutar is our number two seed. And, of course, on top of the stack this week, Earl Anthony. He's getting closer. This time it's a two-pin.
I think he's thinking in his mind about moving. He did try and practice moving inside closer to the third arrow. It appears that the ball grabs the lane a little bit better inside. Although the left-handers don't seem to have too much trouble getting the ball to hook back. I know Earl said that they were really hooking for him.
Quite a bit more than they had throughout the week. And they were hooking the entire lane, not only the first 15 feet, but the middle of the lane and the back end as well. Lee Taylor right now in the spare mode, but that might not be enough to handle this gentleman from Kent, Washington.
Takes very little time. Kind of a balk there. He started and stopped. Maybe that's the way to do it.
Didn't seem to change the result much. Flush hit on lane 28 for Darrel Curtis.
Watch the three pin as it crunches the six. Third from your right, goes to the sideboard, and just nicked that six going by. Did you see that?
Mm-hmm. Just enough. Up by 24, could increase it to 34 with a strike here on the left-hand lane, lane 27.
Well, it's nice to see somebody getting some strikes.
Well, I have a feeling Mr. Soutar and Mr. Anthony will find the pocket on both sides.
Darrel leaving the 2-4. Seems to have a little bit more trouble with lane 27 than 28.
Seems like the roles are reversed for the left-handers. The ball hooks a little more. The right-handers doesn't want to hook as much.
Hooks a little earlier for the left hand.
Right. Which one would you rather have?
I'd rather have it hooking.
Me too. At least you know where it's going. Yeah, when you throw that thing out there and it goes pretty much dead straight for 60 feet, it's either get out the sandpaper or head for San Francisco.
It's interesting that you mentioned that because I went down to practice today on a couple pair over, and it was a PBA shot on that pair, and that's basically what my ball did, goes straight for 60 feet. So I did that. I got out the sandpaper and got a little bit of a hook.
Right. And the minute the sandpaper wore off, see, because I think that's half the problem for Lee. I think if he sends it a little bit, like remember Glenn Allison, every time he sent it a little right, there wasn't a chance it was coming back. Then you start setting it short, cutting it off a little bit, trying to guide it, and that's when you start throwing the ball left.
It's the old adage, I mean, that when you don't have much to aim at, that swing just tightens up and the span gets shorter and everything gets tougher.
And, of course, in the old days, then you would have moved a little further right and just started throwing rockets. Or no?
I don't know what I'd do right now if I were Lee. I think I'd move inside if I were Lee right now. Get somewhere on the lane where it was going to bite the lane. Because where he's going right now, he hasn't hit the pocket yet.
Down by 24. At the midway point. Yeah, I think in his mind, it's time for a move, or do you become a little more conservative and say, hey, you know, there's always the possibility that Darrel Curtis could open somewhere down the line.
Well, he's still in the match. 20 pins can happen, change in a frame easily.
Flirting with disaster. One shot after another. He's been fortunate, to be quite honest with you, to still be close in the match.
Right, he could be shooting 150 right now real easily with some bad breaks.
Of course, after missing a 10-pin in the opening frame, it hasn't gotten much better for Lee Taylor here in match number two.
a stir up for Lee Taylor, but he trails by 26. When we come back to Escondido, California, we'll finish up match number two.
To get rid of her gray, my wife can spend 40 minutes. But I discovered the 5-minute hair coloring.
The revolutionary discovery called Just for Men from the leader in men's hair coloring. Simply apply Just for Men and in 5 minutes shampoo out.
Gray is blended away. The look of my natural color is back in 5 minutes.
That was me.
And it won't fade or wash out.
My hair takes forever, but you look great in just 5 minutes.
The look of your natural color in just 5 minutes with Just for Men.
Burger King takes on America's favorite breakfast. Today,
the same old thing, prepackaged and efficient, same old, same old.
At Burger King, we've got the new sausage breakfast buddy sandwich for just 59 cents. It's eggs and cheese with spicy sausage, all on a little buddy bun. It's definitely not the
same old, same old.
The new sausage breakfast buddy for just 59 cents, only at Burger King. Now, for a limited time, buy a new breakfast buddy and get a free Schick Slim Twin disposable razor.
And you knew it had to happen. Darrel Curtis with a double while we were away.
Naturally, we can't get any strikes on the air. But
ah, there's Lee Taylor, and the fans erupt. All right, Lee, remember that shot. Remember the timing and the tempo. Go up and do the same thing on lane 27.
And again, no double dribble there or double bounce with the ball. But he's got to be so perfect then. But he better strike now, or at 36 pins, there's a lot to catch up in just 3 frames.
257 for Darrel Curtis if he takes this one right out the window. 221 for Lee Taylor. Might not be enough.
I'd like to see it right now. 221 sounds pretty good to me.
So would Lee at this point. More aggressive shot there. Come on, hold the pocket, and it does. So Taylor gathers himself for one last charge up the hill. The question is, the king of the hill right now, Darrel Curtis, may just be too far ahead.
Well, again, in pressure situations, Darrel has a tendency to go high. So let's see. Put a little pressure on him. Let's see what happens here. This is his good lane. Perfect. Absolutely perfect.
That may be the best shot he's thrown.
Yeah. Puts it right back to 36 pins, and oh, it can put the match virtually out of reach with one more strike. Right over about the first arrow, the sixth board. Ball just finishes perfectly in the 1-2 pocket.
Trying to apply the tourniquet. And a nice shot, but the six pin stands tall.
Had good speed. He was aggressive on that all the way. He was a little right of his target, but the speed held the ball in the pocket, and he got away with just the spare.
Last night in the position round game, he was sixth, just kind of hoping to hang around, maybe get to the number five position, and he ended up going all the way to third.
Right. Shot 226 or something like that, moved all the way to third.
Solid game thus far for Darrel Curtis. Other than the very first frame, he leads by 35.
Lee is still not out of it. He can get one here in the ninth and two in the tenth. The must-strike situation, Eddie. Just a hurry. Nice shot.
Nice shot for Lee Taylor, who slices the rack on the right-hand lane. Darrel switches chairs, and now the burning question for Lee Taylor, can he continue to strike?
Well, you know, I had him moving inside 3 frames ago. He knew what he was doing. He's got to stay right where he's at, made better shots, and gotten a turkey, and one more, and he can get himself back in the match.
It's funny because he seems to be much more relaxed now in the last 3 or 4 frames than he was in the early stages of game number two.
And there's more pressure now. You wonder why.
One more, and they get it. You know what it is? It's that survival instinct that kicks in.
It's interesting, though, Dan. Psychologically, a player has a tendency, when he's behind like this, as we see Lee come in light here and just sweep him off with a power shot, and his reaction there, that he's come back to this point, and he's to the point now, one more strike, and he really makes Darrel show up. And sometimes they don't get this one here.
Darrel Curtis doesn't look overly concerned at this point. Oh, he set it short, waves for the Brooklyn, and Lee Taylor gets it with a big smile.
But you see the difference mentally on that shot? He wasn't nearly as aggressive, as nearly as relaxed. He had to get the break to get that strike. But, as you talked about a few frames ago, 221 with a strike now. He's only five pins behind. Darrel Curtis is definitely going to need a mark with good count.
Amazing how these things flip-flop around. Halfway through this match, you got to figure there's no chance for Lee Taylor to win.
And no chance for him to shoot 221.
Oh, no. No. Finishes strong, a solid game of 220 for Lee Taylor, who comes bouncing back after a very sluggish start here in the second game. This is the good lane for Darrel Curtis.
And he needs to count 15 in the 10th frame. High. We talked about him going high under pressure. He said, Lee, if you can get a Brooklyn, so can I.
High wasn't the word for that shot. You called it, Mike. And there you see is one thing you probably won't see on the PBA National Tour that you will see on the Seniors Tour is something like that, where he's throwing an errant shot, he gets away with a strike, and pats the other guy on the back, and there's a smile, and, hey, I'll buy you a cold one later on. You do that to a guy on the National Tour, he's liable to grab your arm and rip it right off. Well, he needed a break, and he got one. Really, other than the shot in the first frame and that one right there in the 10th, it was a very solid game for Darrel Curtis.
Yeah, obviously he's got a good ball reaction when he throws the ball well. He's got two Hall of Famers ahead of him, though, to win his first senior title.
Oh, the road's not going to get any easier. Of course, he's come close to winning a PBA title. He lost to Hall of Famer Titus Semez in the finals in Canton back in 1987. We'll take a break here from Palomar Lanes in Escondido, California. Coming up next, the semifinal game. Darrel Curtis and Dave Soutar.
Decisions, decisions. At Carpet Den, we make home decorating decisions easy. Let us help you choose from a wide variety of top quality products to suit all your home interior needs. Come see carpets and other floor coverings, beautiful window treatments, decorative wallpaper, and a colorful array of designer paint. Come and coordinate colors and style, all at the Carpet Den, your total decorating center where decisions are a snap.
Don't forget, coming up Sunday, Mike, baseball season just around the corner. We've got some exhibition baseball. The Oakland Athletics and the San Francisco Giants live from sunny Scottsdale, Arizona, 3 o'clock p.m. Eastern Time, noon Pacific Time.
And, of course, everybody thought last year in the World Series that the A's were the invincible team, and the Reds showed them that they weren't. Good Ohio team that we're rooting for.
That's right. Now, what about Henderson, Ricky Henderson? Do you think he's going to continue to play for the Athletics?
Well, I don't know. I saw in the paper this morning he's demanding a trade. So we'll see.
I've got it right now. I think Henderson for Durbin straight up.
Yeah.
And 9 or 10 players to be named later.
Thanks, Dad. Thanks. Can I have part of his salary?
Yes,
too?
You can. The interest on his salary would probably be as much as you're making right now. Curtis comes out, starts the way he finished game number two with a strike.
Well, this is the absolute pair that Dave Soutar bowled 300 on against Earl Anthony, by the way, in a match play yesterday. Let's see if he still likes it.
Classic style of Dave Soutar. Whack! Ringing 10 to start the match.
See the difference, though, in the bowling ball, where Lee Taylor's ball wouldn't hook back like that. Soupy gotten a ball that's going to finish a little bit for him, and it always makes you feel a little more comfortable then when you know you can throw that ball at least a board to the right and it's going to come back.
Was the leader after 35 games, lost a tough position round match to Earl Anthony and the lead in the process.
Well, it came down to the 10th frame. Well, there's the two wives there, Sandy and Judy, and they once bowled the national doubles together. How about that, huh?
Notice they're not speaking to each other at this point?
Well, Soutar switched to a four-step approach last year, pushes it out, and notice how the ball's slightly late in timing. Going up still at the third step, pulls it through, though, and makes it work for himself.
One fan said, how about a strike? Well, that's exactly what he got. Soutar with a couple of very good shots with a spare and a strike to open up this match.
And as I was saying, Soutar came down last night, needed a double in the 10th frame to be the tournament lead. Got the first one, left a solid 7 the second ball of the 10th.
Curtis tugs it a little bit, comes up and sits, though, and that was an interesting delivery.
Wasn't it? You thought the same thing I did. I thought that ball was going high, and he had good speed on it. Again, I think his target's right around the first arrow. Five-step player, short backswing. That's definitely right of the first arrow. But that's the result, Dennis.
That thumb went down early. Now, this was a better shot. A strike for Curtis, who comes out of the gates with the first three. So Dave Soutar can waste little time in throwing a double.
And Curtis just says, what Hall of Famer? What do you mean Hall of Famer?
Another good shot, four-pin wiggles. You know, you mentioned that solid 7 that he left in the second shot in the 10th last night. Told me he opened the game against Earl by leaving a 4-9. He hadn't left a 4-9 or a solid 7 all week long.
As they say, it's the rub of the synthetic.
That's right. The rub. How about the snag of the synthetic? I like that better.
Okay.
The snub of the synthetic.
Yeah, at least that's alliterate.
Ball goes racing by, a spare for Soutar in the third, and he is down by 20, and he's yet to miss the pocket.
Before he can sneeze, he's down by 20.
It's like going out in match play and losing two of the three first holes and going par-par birdie. If anybody can keep it together, though, and make good shots down the stretch, this gentleman right here. Ooh, got a little wide with that shot on 27. Was that an area check or just an errant toss?
Well, it's a strike as far as I could see. Again, he's aiming about the 7th board. It looks like this one is about over the 6th. I mean, he's allowed to throw the board, right?
Yep.
And the light mixer, which is a high percentage hit on the PBA Tour.
Back to live action. And that thumb went down a little early, and there you see, Darrel knew it.
Yeah, he knew it. What Denny means when that thumb goes down early is the player is trying to stay behind the ball as long as he can before he turns that ball. And the tendency is not to trust it and to turn that thumb a little bit early and that ball a little early. As he goes for the 2-4-7, makes the spare. And the general result of that is the ball goes high. If you're a right-hander, it's left of target. And if you're a left-hander, it's right of target.
17-pin match, but Soutar working on a strike. The winner of this one gets to bowl Earl Anthony for the title.
Right. Goody, goody, goody.
No problem. Oh, you and I were just commenting about his television record, too. Earl with what, 176? Six games on national television?
91 and 85.
That's a longer run than I Love Lucy.
Almost longer run than Johnny Carson, huh?
Oh, I'm going to tell you. A lot of experience. Trying to tighten this match up. Is the Hall of Famer Dave Soutar going to need some help? And he does get it. The 5-pin looked like a Durbin shot at the very last moment caving in.
And all that matters is that they fall over, Dennis. Now watch it. The ball is going to deflect here. The 4-5 is up there for a split second. There it is. That 2-pin went back and got the 5-pin. Did you see that? That's how to make the 4-5 with the first ball.
Finally fell. Took it a while. this one right here gives him the lead.
He heard somebody. Somebody distracted him. Or in the back, he's saying. He heard the mechanic or somebody back there. It's amazing how we professional bowlers have these rabbit ears, or we can hear anything and everything. Maybe they had to wear cotton in our ears or something.
Did you ever try that?
No, I never did. Boom, boom, trouble.
That better hang on. So Soutar, disoriented, misses the 10-pin. That could cost him dearly here in the semifinal game. We'll be back to wrap things up here in game number three after we take this time out. Darrel Curtis leads, and he's looking to win.
I like what shampoo and conditioner do for my hair, but I love what Pert Plus does for me. Pert Plus is a unique shampoo and conditioner in one, so my hair turns out just the way I like it. Clean, conditioned, looking great, but without the bother of two bottles. Imagine, hair I like without the fuss. That's what Pert Plus does for me. If only everything in my life was so simple.
Wash and go with Pert Plus, also in dandruff control. What's it like to break the mold? Taste the cold of Diet 7-Up.
Taste the cold. Taste the cold.
Feel it take you a few degrees away from the everyday. Diet 7-Up with NutraSweet. Break the ice.
If you added up all the potato chips you've eaten during poker nights and playoff games, you'd end up with some serious spuds. But you still wouldn't have a taste as big as these little Gino pizza rolls. Ooh, a tremendous taste of zesty pizza and a hot little bite-sized snack. A taste so big, it makes ordinary chips seem like small potatoes. Gino's Pizza Rolls, the pizza way to snack.
Plastic bottles and bags in our waterways are more than a litter problem. They kill. Hi, I'm Gary Jobson, ESPN sailing analyst. Don't throw your trash overboard. Remember, you can make a world of difference.
Here you see the remnants of a split in the seventh frame for Darrel Curtis.
Curtis struck the frame before this to take a commanding lead, and he's given Soutar a life here, and he got eight out on this spare, throwing away two pins.
Meanwhile, Soutar trails by 14. He's trying to change that right now, and boy, he's had the light hits here in the semifinal game.
If he'd stay light, he'd strike every time right now, but perhaps the key shot of the match coming up right now on his favorite lane, he's got to strike here to cut this lead to four pins.
All right, I'm going to bring up a point after this, and I want you to talk about it, concerning how you're supposed to actually line up to throw strikes. All right, I'll get back to that. Remind me.
Hi. Ooh, he tripped the four. He says if I stay out of the pocket solid, I'm all right.
All right, now, he has had tremendous striking ability when he's thrown the ball white. He threw two shots flush, left a solid 10-pin, left a 4-pin. That time he tripped it out. Are you supposed to line up to throw the ball light in the pocket?
He's lined up to hit solid, but if he misses a little right, he's going to hit light, and he's striking better there. As Darrel strikes. But commenting on your position or point there, if I were lined up on a lane and I was hitting light and striking, I wouldn't move to get flush. Now, that's just how I have it.
Okay.
As long as I was striking, I didn't fool with it.
That's what I was looking for. Curtis with a key strike in the eighth. Boy, this one's turned out to be a dandy match in the semifinal. Hope these guys don't wear each other out because Mr. Anthony's next.
Good shot.
Wall shot for Curtis, who comes sweeping back with a double of his own.
Well, we have a potential of 237 to 241 here. Both of them take it out. Soutar can get 237 if he goes all the way. Back down to 14 pins behind. He needs a strike here.
Positive side for Soutar is he gets to finish first.
The light hit works better. See, that puts him down 15. It means if he strikes out in the 10th, he's still going to be behind by 5. Right about over his target, just broke, you know, about 6 inches too soon right there in the middle of the lane, and it was 4 pin high all the way.
Carry has been an interesting subject here in the semifinal game, but when you really come right back down to it, it was the miss in the sixth frame that really hurt him.
And it unnerves your confidence. Even though he came back with a double after that, and he's experienced, he just knows that he let something get away there. That was the frame, though, that he also heard somebody yell.
Yeah, there was some commotion in the back end, we're told, and disrupted his shot. Trying to get something done here in the 10th, went light with it, didn't carry, and for Dave Soutar right now, he's thinking about third place.
Yeah. But as we watched Del Ballard a couple of weeks ago, and that will probably live forever in bowling annals, you never know what's going to happen, so make the spare and sit down and see.
This is one that Dave will probably think to himself as he travels to San Francisco next week that may just have gotten away from him.
Right.
Last couple of games between the position round last night and this one. But he's been through the wars, this gentleman. He's seen the good and the bad of the professional ranks. And that's about as bad as it gets right there. Pocket 7-10. Disappointing. Dave Soutar, Judy, his wife, trying to ponder the future.
Curtis basically needing just to keep it on the lane. Stay behind the foul line. That's a winner.
Not only kept it on the lane, but he swept everything else off. Darrel Curtis with a beautiful shot in the 10th. So we'll wrap things up here in the semifinal game. For Dave Soutar, a fine third place finish. For Darrel Curtis, a date with Earl Anthony.
Journey into the past. The Strasburg Railroad in Lancaster County, preserving America's past for the future.
Why have over 400,000 GM owners chosen Mercury in the past decade? One reason is the value found in Mercury Grand Marquis. No other car in its class retains more of its value, and no traditional full-size car gives you such a valuable list of features. Powerful V8 engine, 6-passenger room, the largest trunk of any American-made car, and a standard driver's side airbag supplemental restraint system. Mercury Grand Marquis. Discover the value yourself at your Lincoln Mercury dealers.
All right, this week's championship frame recap is brought to you by Midas. Let's take a look back early on in this championship round to game number one and a costly miss for Glenn Allison.
Well, he was in a position that Lee Taylor had just opened. If he struck out, he put the pressure on him. He missed the head pin and then shot the spare and missed the head pin again. He thought he had it covered, but nevertheless, it was two errant shots, and that's his reaction. My goodness, he says, no!
How could that happen? Low-scoring affair in game number one, 181, a 166, as Lee Taylor, the local pro from Carlsbad, California, advanced into game number two. And, of course, he was taking on Darrel Curtis, a man who threw 8 strikes in his opening game.
And Lee struck out to make Darrel get a mark in the 10th frame, and Darrel said, well, as my dad used to say, when in doubt, go Brooklyn. And he trips the 4-pin.
And, of course, you followed that advice so many times throughout your career.
What, didn't it work? I mean, you saw it work for Darrel there.
234 to 220. Good finish for both players there in game number two. Then it was on to the semifinal match as Darrel Curtis was then keyed to bowl against Dave Soutar.
This is his shot in the 9th frame of that game, really putting the pressure to Soutar, trusting it, coming in with the light mixer. Soutar then put in the position of needing to strike and didn't do it.
So for Darrel Curtis, He moves on now to the championship game as he defeated Dave Soutar, 230 to 202. And don't forget that this week's championship frame recap has been brought to you by Midas. And when we come back, two lefties, Earl Anthony, Darrel Curtis, for the title in Escondido.
One athlete has been on the cover of Sports Illustrated more than any other. A fierce competitor who knew no fear in or out of the ring.
I'll fight that chump in a telephone booth.
Muhammad Ali, boxing's best. And now you can get the incredible story of this sports legend captured on video free with your paid subscription to Sports Illustrated. You'll get an electrifying look at Muhammad Ali only SI can deliver. Free.
I'm the fastest thing on 2 feet, man.
You'll relive it all. His greatest fights, the guts and the glory. From gold medal winning triumph at the Olympic Games onto the startling rope-a-dope victory in Zaire over a young champion named George Foreman. Recall the grace, the charm, the showmanship, and the mouth.
One more time, who's the champ of the world?
Call this toll-free number now and save over 50% off the cover price. Plus, get the Ali video free. You'll see the heated rivalries, including the three brutal confrontations with Smokin' Joe Frazier, Ali's stunning defeat in Madison Square Garden, up to the thriller in Manila.
And a thriller and a killer when I get the gorilla in Manila.
Definitely one of his most devastating battles ever. Get 23 issues of SI for three easy monthly installments of $9.89 each. That's over 50% off the cover price. You can put it on your credit card. You'll even get the baseball preview and the 1991 swimsuit issue, revealing the latest trends in beachwear, along with the Muhammad Ali video free.
Muhammad Ali is the world heavyweight champion for the third time.
Call now. You'll save big on Sports Illustrated and get the free video that must be the greatest.
I'm a bad man. I shook up the world.
The total number of cheese puffs that you've eaten during championship wrestling and church picnics would add up to one profound puff. But you still wouldn't have a taste as big as these little Gino's pizza rolls. A tremendous taste of zesty pizza and a hot little bite-sized snack. A taste so big, it makes cheese puffs seem a little flat. Gino's Pizza Rolls, the pizza way to snack.
Earl Anthony, Darrel Curtis. You know, these guys have faced each other on a number of occasions up there in the great Northwest.
They're both from the Northwest. I bet they bowl each other a lot of times.
But never for a title. Curtis comes out. Ooh, good shot left the fast eight, Michael.
Earl and his practice balls had nothing. But I'll tell you, Dan, I watched him in the practice balls last night before the position round, and he had nothing, and he went spare eight back. So, this guy is amazing.
You don't have to say anything more. He is reasonably inventive.
It's amazing, too, because he's really not a positive thinker. He's a positive doer.
Big difference.
Now he's going with it, basically the ball that he's used for spares all week.
And now he's turning them into strikes as he shakes his head.
The lanes are hooking quite a bit for Earl. Where he's playing, right around the second arrow, they're hooking. Darrel Curtis is out further. Why Earl doesn't want to try out there with another ball, I don't know. I guess he says this will work here. Comes in light, just barely gets the five, but it goes into the 10, knocks it out.
Four seniors titles, 41 national championships.
42 seconds.
Steps up, throws a double, and he has nothing out there, Mike.
Yeah, right.
I'm convinced he does that to try and throw off his opponents.
You think so? I don't know. I'll tell you.
Not I've really, seen but him I thought it. I'd make that up.
I've seen him do it so many times.
The moment you tell him he can't do something, then you're in big trouble. because you know he's going to do it. Curtis kind of stood up a little on that shot and was very fortunate that he didn't leave the six pin along with the nine.
You suppose he's taking notice of who he's bullying?
I'm going to say you're probably right. But he's a game competitor, this Darrel Curtis. I don't see him backing up. I mean, I think he'll come out and fire some shots in there and see if he can put some heat on Earl Anthony.
Well, he's had, what, eight strikes in each of his first two games? I don't see him getting eight strikes against Earl, but we'll see.
Well, he's 0 for 2.
Pretty good shot there.
Yep. Real good shot. Good release. Darrel was hoping for an X there. Leaves another six pin. Worst comes to worst, he's got three spares.
He's got three spares, though, and he could be down 32 pins. So if Earl steps up and throws a couple more strikes.
And there's a reasonable chance that that could happen.
Well, we'll see.
How did you fare through the years against Mr. Anthony in the championship round?
I bowled him twice. Bowled him in Milwaukee in 1981 and set the record by beating him by the most number of pins ever in a championship match. And then bowled him for the PBA national title, probably suffered my most bitter defeat ever. Lost to him in the PBA national championship in 1983.
Mm-hmm. One and one.
One and one.
Trying to make it three in a row. And Earl has nothing out there.
You know, I'm telling you, he decided at the last minute to use that ball. Five steps, shuffles. Never has been a heel-toe player. He kind of shuffles those feet up there. Look how high the backswing is now, Dan. Was never that high when he was on the national tour. Even the elbow's still slightly bent, a la Don Carter. Interesting, two of the three greatest bowlers of all time had the bent elbow style. Meaning Carter and Anthony, as opposed to Weber with the straight golden arm swing.
I mean, that's what I've been doing wrong all these years?
Well, you ought to swing like your golf swing.
I'm going to go to that. Earl, oh, the light hit this time. So the first time that he's really missed the pocket. But he's out to an early lead over his friend Darrel Curtis.
3-5-6. Be interesting to see where he shoots this from, whether he moves right and shoots it from the right side of the lane or shoots it off his strike target. Off the strike target.
Ooh. Hit all three pins with the ball. Blood pressure up a few counts, but a spare for Anthony in the fourth, and he leads by 19.
Well, Darrel says at least he's human. He stopped striking.
Oh, yeah, when the string ends, then you feel like you've gotten a major break. Up to Darrel to get something started. Now. And he does.
Most important shot of the week coming up for Darrel right now, in my opinion, Ben. He's 19 pins behind. If he strikes now, he gets that lead under 10, and he shows Earl that he's in this match and can compete with him. And he wants a re-rack.
I wonder if this is because they're off spot or because he wants to take another moment or two to gather himself, because this could be the big shot.
I don't think so. I think they're off spot. Darrel's just a get him and fire him type guy. Goose Gossage, when he used to pitch for the Yankees, you know, he gets it and he goes.
Needs a strike badly, and he gets it. So now it's a nine-pin match, and at least he has Earl's attention.
He's definitely got Earl's attention. Good shot here. See that follow-through go out to the left there? Right over the target. Perfect in the 1-2 pocket. See how Doomsday reacts to that.
Same as usual, just throw it in the pocket.
I know, but it didn't all fall down this time.
Six-pin stands for Anthony in the fifth.
See, what that means, Dan, is no matter what Earl does, he makes a spare and comes back with a strike, Curtis can take the lead with one more strike. Of course, between these two players, you probably have two of the players that take the least amount of time of any two players in the history of bowling.
But that says a lot for being decisive and knowing what you want to do. I mean, you have to get into a rhythm. You have to let your body do what it knows what to do. You stand up there and think about 14 or 15 different things, you're never going to get the job done.
Well, there's an argument to that. I mean, Nicholas on the golf tour has thought about things for years.
Sure,
and been the greatest player of all time. So.
Yeah, you're right. Wonderful shot. Hack City for Anthony, who continues to go about things in a businesslike fashion.
Very businesslike, very professional. For the lead, tie. Good break, only the 10 pin.
That was better than a good break. That was a wonderful break.
Yeah, right.
And Earl's saying that was a bad break.
Again, right of target, thumb down, as you said, a little early, and could have had anything up there. If you get nine and a spare out of that, you got to walk onto the next frame and say, wonderful.
Stretches out, covers the 10 nicely. Spare up for Darrel Curtis in the sixth. That's all right, just relax.
She's definitely not relaxed.
No, she's not. But she's having fun.
Hey, her husband's going to make at least $4,400. Has to hurry.
Ooh, did it ever. Fingers Curtis on that shot. Came back out of nowhere on lane 27. So Darrel Curtis with a strike in the seventh. Earl now working on a strike in the sixth. Leads by nine with a double here. Can start to move out a little bit. You win 41 national titles by coming through in the clutch. And speaking of clutch bowling and Hall of Famers, Dave Soutar, oh my, he's in the ABC Hall of Fame. A few pounds lighter. Earl Anthony, obviously a Hall of Famer. And coming up next week during our telecast in the San Francisco area, we'll have a special report on the 50th annual ABC convention, which is taking place right now in Toledo, Ohio.
This very minute. Oh, he's too good. You know what I tell you? He's just too good.
And Anthony has nothing out there.
Right. Now Darrel better get something or he's going to have second.
Isn't that amazing?
Oh, he's amazing.
Well, he is a phenomenal player. Mind over matter. Come on, Darrel. He comes back with a strike of his own, so Curtis has done anything but give up in this match.
But he's got a strike here in the ninth. He absolutely, he's 29 pins down. No, he's 19 pins down. One more strike and he cuts it to within 9 pins. And he wants a re-rack. Or no, his ball just hasn't come back. That's it. He's taking his time getting back. Maybe the ball's afraid. I don't know.
He had a slight mechanical problem with the ball return before he went on the air this evening, but the mechanics hustled over and put it back together. It's worked beautifully.
Mr. Hurry.
The Durbin Slash-O-Matic strike for Darrel Curtis, who just unleashed a powerful shot there.
Trusted this one all the way. Comes in light. Destroys the 5-pin into the 10. Puts this match back within 9 pins. And says, Anthony, let's see you perform now.
Well, Earl enjoys this type of competition, Mike. He enjoys the challenge.
He sure does. I'll tell you what, he trusted that ball so well. That was his best shot of the match right there. Oh, pretty.
And in his heyday, and he still is in his heyday, when that ball never leaves the ground, the lane keeps rolling right into the pit unaffected, that's when you know Earl's got the super roll going.
One more, and he locks it up.
stood up on it a little bit, Michael. Stood up on that shot just a little bit and flipped it. And there you see Earl is upset with himself.
What he does, though, is he gives Darrel light. Darrel Curtis now can win this tournament by stepping up and throwing a couple of strikes. Watch Earl. The head is always steady. Usually a nice long slide. But at this point, you can hardly tell it from there.
Mm. He was just up out of the crouch a little quicker than normal.
What he's going to do is wind up with a strike. He'll wind up with 245. Darrel Curtis with two strikes and nine can wind up with 246.
Potential tie.
Oh, we could have.
I like
right.
to say that. Don't you? Our director, Kent Samuel, said, well,
no way, guys.
He had to look at the clock first.
Please, no tie.
Oh, Kent loves close matches. So does this man. Wonderful game bowled by Earl Anthony, who, as Mike Durbin alluded to just prior to the opening shot, came out to his practice balls, had virtually nothing with the ball he used in the practice session, went to the spare ball, and promptly shot 244.
And it may not be enough. Well, Curtis won't waste any time. I'll tell you, one more and eight and a spare. No, one more and eight. What am I saying? Just one more and eight, and he's a winner.
Well, a couple of weeks ago, Del Ballard needed two and seven.
So anything can happen, you're telling me.
That was a wonderful shot. Needs another. And if you're going to win your first title, what better way to do it than to come from behind and knock off one of the all-time greats?
Maybe the all-time great. Eight pins. Seven, we have a tie and a two-frame roll-up. Eight or better. We have a two. Earl will start on the left lane. 244 tie.
Nothing is a gimme. How many times have we said it? Two brilliant shots by Curtis. And now we have a two-frame roll-off. And the fans here in Escondido are heating up, and they're ready to enjoy it. Earl asking for quiet, and he gets it. And he actually has second life.
Definitely.
Come on, come on. Little slap of a six. Anthony starts with a strike. Now Curtis, who threw two beautiful shots, will have to step up and try and throw an extra on lane 28.
How does he compose it? I couldn't do it, Denny. If I were Curtis, I'd be a basket case right now. What a bad break. But if he'd have done that the frame before, he was a winner. Now he has to make this.
Unbelievable.
6-8 on a wonderfully executed shot. He just threw it too well.
Earl contemplating that could have been a very disappointing loss. Now he's thinking about winning once again. Give it room. Curtis says, take that. Done yet.
I'll tell you what. What's a great finish. We start slow tonight. Watch this just drive through and leave that 6-8 rather. And here's the conversion. Oh, we're going to catch him in the middle of his approach with this replay.
Back to live action. And a much better shot. A gritty. Gritty performance for Darrel Curtis, who had the title, gave it back. Now he's trying to just grab on with both hands again.
I don't know who's going to win this, Dan. I'll tell you, this is one of the best I've ever seen.
Just goes to show you that the PBA Senior Tour is every bit as exciting as any tour in professional bowling.
And we know these lanes aren't easy. The way these guys are performing,
possible 50 for Curtis if he throws a couple of more strikes.
Oh. One more and he makes Anthony get two in the 10th frame.
Well, we hope you've enjoyed the action with us this evening. Keep in mind, we're on once again next week, 8 o'clock Eastern Time, from Colma, California. Curtis starting to run him out, slap his hands together. He goes spare on the conversion of the split. Strike, strike, strike for 50.
Watch this light hit. He just crushed this left lane all the way through the match. And here's his reaction. That's pretty good for a 57-year-old guy. A lot of room, too much room. That's it. Curtis is the winner. Curtis is the winner. Don't even need to finish it.
What a performance from Darrel Curtis and Earl Anthony as Darrel Curtis steps into the winner's circle on the PBA National Tour by winning the $75,000 AMF HPL Senior PBA Open in front of a capacity crowd here at Palomar Lanes in Escondido, California.
Tomorrow morning, experience a new high. Introducing Mountain Fresh Dial, with a scent so big, so bold, so bracing, it's right up there with your peak experiences. New Mountain Fresh Dial.
When it comes to delivered pizza, you know who gets there sooner. If you want it hot and you want it fresh, you want it sooner. Now for just $9.99, get two medium two-topping pizzas called Domino's Pizza.
The sooner the better.
To get rid of her gray, my wife can spend 40 minutes. But I discovered the 5-minute hair coloring.
The revolutionary discovery called Just for Men from the leader in men's hair coloring. Simply apply Just for Men and in 5 minutes shampoo out.
Gray is blended away. The look of my natural color is back in 5 minutes.
That was me.
And it won't fade or wash out.
My hair takes forever, but you look great in just 5 minutes.
The look of your natural color in just 5 minutes with Just for Men.
My wife sent me to Payless for some shoes. I didn't even know Payless had men's shoes. Well, right away, I liked the place because there's no salespeople breathing down your neck. And they got all the shoes out. So you don't have to keep saying, you got this in a 10? Have you got this in a 10? For once, I get a pair of shoes I like with no hassle. You ought to call it painless.
Right now at Payless, these men's shoes are on sale starting at just $12.99. For shoe shopping that's painless, who'd have guessed? Payless.
Live, Top Rank Boxing on ESPN. The place where fighters have stepped into the ring as unknowns, made the right connection, and emerged as champions.
You gotta knock them off to win this, all right?
Olympic hero Michael Carvajal. The IBF title is his, and he's not giving it up without a fight against challenger Javier Vargas. It's another Championship Sunday on Top Rank Boxing, live on ESPN.
The championship round finals of the $75,000 AMF HPL Senior Open have been brought to you by Midas. For mufflers, brakes, and shocks, nobody beats Midas, nobody. And by Burger King. If you want to give people what they really want, sometimes you've got to break the rules. A memorable first win for Darrel Curtis. He beat Earl Anthony in sudden death to win his very first championship. John Siddharth, Lane's product manager from AMF, and also Jim Campbell, the general manager here in Escondido, presenting the trophy and the check. And Mike, it was a wonderful finish.
And he'll be happy to show this video to his grandchildren and say, I beat Earl.
Next week, the PBA Senior Tour heads up to Sarah Lanes, located in